In this video, we will work on practice problems, practice calculations for integrated rate laws. So we've already introduced the equations that we use and how we could identify the overall order of a reaction using graphs. Now we will use our calculations for practice. In our first example, we're told the half-life of a reaction is listed as 8.06 minutes at 110 degrees Celsius. We're told the reaction is first order in A. So notice again, the order of the reaction doesn't necessarily match the coefficient. And we're asked to solve for time. We want to know how long it takes for A to decrease from 1.25 molar to 0.71 molar. So if we start by listing all of the information we're given, this is not required for setup, but it does help you figure out what you need to use in order to solve the problem. So again, remember half-life is our T sub 1/2. That is a time of 8.06 minutes. Notice that we're given temperature here, but we don't include temperature in any of our integrated rate law equations. For integrated rate laws, we're simply looking at reactant concentration over time. The reason that temperature is included is because when we calculate rate constants, those are temperature dependent. And so it's very common to be given temperature even if we're not using it in a calculation. Now, it is important to recognize we're told that this is first order. We should see as soon as we're given that information, we know that we're using our natural log function. And again, we're solving for time. We want to know how long it's going to take for A to decrease from an initial concentration of 1.25 molar to a final concentration of 0.71 molar. Helpful tip for you here. Anytime we're calculating a change in concentration, remember we're always looking at reactants. With both rate laws and integrated rate laws, we only look at reactants. And reactants always decrease. And so the initial quantity for a reactant is always going to be the larger value. The final will always be the smaller. Reactants will always decrease over time. Realize if I want to use my first order integrated rate law using the natural log function, I have to know a rate constant and I have to know T. Well, T is our unknown. That's what we want to solve for. And realize that I don't have K yet. However, I can use my half-life to solve for K. Remember, for a first order reaction, we have the half-life equation of 0.693 over K over our rate constant. And if I want to isolate K and solve for that, I can manipulate this equation to become 0.693 over my half-life to solve for K. Let's make that a little neater. There we go. So 0.693 divided by half-life will give us K. So again, 0.693 divided by the 8.06 minutes. And when we calculate that, we get a half-life of a rate constant of 0.08598 with units of inverse time. Remember, for a first order, K is always going to have units of inverse time. I can leave this in minutes because it asks for time, but it doesn't specify units here. And so that means when I do solve for time, that will end up being in minutes. So now I know my K value. Again, don't necessarily need to list it over here, but helpful to keep track of what we know and what we don't know. So our first order integrated rate law is this function. When I plug in my quantities, my final concentration is on top. Initial concentration on bottom. And again, recognize they're in the same unit, so those will automatically cancel. If they weren't in the same unit, we'd have to convert one to the other. It wouldn't matter which one we converted as long as they're in the same unit. For order of operations here, because we know both values of concentration, you can get a numerical value for this left-hand side of our equation. So natural log, pay attention to order of operations. Be sure to put this ratio in parentheses to get a final answer. And then, of course, to isolate t, we need to divide by the negative. Common mistake is forgetting to move that negative over. The negative of our rate constant. So you're welcome to do this all as one input in your calculator. Again, just paying attention to order of operations, dividing by our negative k at the end. When we solve for time, again, we will be left with minutes. Notice we have inverse minutes in the denominator, which means we'll end with minutes as our unit. When you calculate your final answer, now we round for sig figs. We're going to go to 2 because our final concentration has 2 sig figs. And so we see here that it takes 6.6 minutes for the reactant to decrease from 1.25 to 0.71. As a quick estimation, realize that we can look at our half-life value to determine if our answer makes sense. So again, remember, our reactant went from 1.25 down to a 0.71 molar. So not one half-life has passed yet. Right, a full half-life hasn't passed. A full half-life life would be around 0.62. So a full half-life hasn't passed yet. That means the time should be less than my 8 minutes. It would take 8 minutes for a full half-life. And so this final answer makes sense. For first order reactions, you can use your half-life to determine if your answer makes sense by quick estimation. The next two practice problems that I have here are similar. For the first one, notice we're given the same general information. We're given half-life. We would need to convert that into our rate constant first. We're given an initial concentration, but then we want to know final concentration. So in this problem, we're actually solving for A sub T, and we know our time. I'm not going to work through the full setup of this one. In the slides, I've left the answers, but a couple of key things to note is your units. Notice half-life is given in minutes, but our time is given in seconds. And so one of these has to be converted to the other. Again, it doesn't matter which one, whichever one's easier or makes more sense for you, but these have to be converted to the same units. And then, of course, in our integrated rate law, we would now be solving for the A sub T value in the top. This means eventually we would have to get rid of our ln function so that we can isolate our final concentration. Remember, getting rid of the ln, we take the inverse function and raise both sides to the e. So watch your order of operations on this one. But again, in the slides, I've left the answers for it. So work this one and check your answers. For our second question down here, again, I'm not going to work through the full thing, but I do want to point out some key notes in here. So it's again, still a first order. Now we're given the rate constant, so we don't have to calculate that. That's already given. We're solving for time. But notice we're working with percentages here. When we're working with percentages, we have to interpret the information that's given. When we're told that 75% of our reactant has reacted, remember that our final amount is always how much is remaining. And so with percentage phrasing, we always have to pay attention to the information that's given. If 75% has reacted, that means there's only 25% that is remaining. So this would actually be our final. Well, if that's our final, realize that we also need to know our initial. Since we're solving for time, we would have to know this information. What's always implied with a percentage problem is that our initial is going to be 100%. It's never going to be stated in a problem. But if you're working with percentages, no matter when we start measuring, even if the reaction has already started, the moment that we start measuring amounts, our initial would be 100 at that point. And so this would be your initial, your final here would be 25. So again, in the notes, I have in your slides, I have the final answers for these. Check your setup and make sure you're getting those. For more practice, you can check examples 12.6 through 12.10. And for our last practice one, we finally have a second order example. So I do want to work through this one just to show you how we would use our second order equation. Remember, second order is where we're working with the inverse of concentration to give us that straight line. Again, here we're given half-life, which means we need to use that information to find our rate constant. We have initial concentration, time, and we want to know final concentration. So again, writing down all of our values, we know that our half-life is 699 seconds. We know our initial concentration is 0.0355 molar. We want to find our final concentration. So we need to find our rate constant first. And we're given a time of 855 seconds. So again, my first step is to use my half-life to solve for K. Remember, our half-life equation is 1 over K times our initial concentration. So again, if I want to isolate K here, this reaction is, or this equation is going to manipulate to become 1 over the product of half-life times initial concentration. And again, watch your order of operations. Make sure your product of the denominator is in parentheses here. And notice our units. Again, the units of K vary by the overall order. And so my value of K with extra digits, because it is not a final answer. Just so you know, typically 2 or 3 extra digits is sufficient for extra. You don't need to write down the entire number from your calculator. And then recognize that our units here, we have molarity and seconds in our denominator. So units of K are m to the negative 1 times s to the negative 1. So that is our K value. Now we look at our second order rate law, which uses the inverse of concentrations. There's our equation. And so now I'm going to start plugging in all of my values. Very helpful to use your units as you go through your setup, because it will help you confirm that everything cancels out. So we have all of this for our setup. Again, watching your order of operations, make sure that inverse of concentration is done in the right order. And when we calculate all of this, we get a value of 62.625. If you check your units, notice that the seconds cancel in our K times T. And so I'm left with M to the negative 1. Remember that that is the same as 1 over molarity, which is good because if I'm adding two quantities, they have to have the same units. And so that means that this has units of 1 over molarity. So first of all, that tells me I'm not done yet because I'm solving for molarity, not inverse of molarity. I also have to remember that I have solved for the inverse of molarity. So if I want to isolate the final concentration, it means I need to take the inverse of this value. Another way I can tell is as a molarity value, 62 should be nonsensical. The largest molarity value possible on the planet is for water, and it has a molarity of 55, I think, for pure water. So this is a nonsensical value, can't possibly be right. Also, remember, we're solving for final concentration. If our initial concentration was 0.0355, we know our final concentration has to be less than that. And so when we carry out our last step and round for sig figs, we go back to our question. Every given value goes to 3 digits. And so I'm going to report this to 3 digits. By the time I round, I'm going to get 0.0160 molarity. And so these are our calculation examples for integrated rate law. Now you are ready to practice on your own.